So in our passage from Acts of the Apostles today, we join the disciples right after Peter's big speech after Pentecost comes, and the early church movement moves from about 120 people to over 3,000 people and those that were added to their number that day. And so we come then at this point of the passage to figure out, okay, there's 3,000 plus people there now. How are they doing this and what's happening? And so from that Acts passage, we have a picture of what they were doing in terms of the prayers that they were coming and sharing at the temple, the breaking of bread, the teaching that they were attending upon, and sharing all things in common. And so we come to the bedrock of discipleship and what it means and what it looks like and how this movement holds us and sends us forward. And it's pretty exciting weekend to be talking about all of this with the confirmation retreat going on and everything else that has happened, because I was able to spend yesterday with the confirmands and meet with each of them, with Pastor Bill and their mentors individually, as we asked them about where they were in accepting Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and where they were in making their commitment to follow him through the United Methodist Church and Epworth Church in particular. Because there are a lot of things, right, that we can put as most important in our lives. There are a lot of people, a lot of gods, a lot of pursuits that we can follow and say that that is what our life is about. But Jesus comes to us in the call from the passage of John, saying that he is the gate as well as the good shepherd, that he brings a promise of life and life abundant, and that anything else will only come to steal and destroy. And as wonderful as it looks from the outset, we will find that it does not hold our best intention of life at heart. But it doesn't mean that the temptation or the draw isn't out there. And it doesn't mean that there isn't a flavor of truth in that temptation, because even the devil, when tempting Jesus in the desert, used scripture and truth, just simply distorted it and manipulated it in such a way that it could serve false ends. So the hardest thing and the most important thing for us, for our confirmands and for all of those who are following Christ, is to know the voice of the shepherd, is to spend time in prayer and in teaching enough so that we can know in the very core of who we are what God's voice is, so that when God calls us, we are able to follow. And that is the entire journey that we are on together today. And we celebrate this moment in Acts when we got it right as the church, because there are plenty of times we're going to have to offer confession where we missed Christ's voice, where we didn't take time to root ourselves in scripture and in teaching and praise and worship and prayer and in sharing, and that harm came and was done through us. But today we get to celebrate the ways that we have shared, what we have done, what God has accomplished through that in us. And this very morning happened all of that, because at the confirmation retreat, I got a call from Jean's son, Scott, saying that they had found bleeding in her brain and she was in ICU. And when you say bleeding in the brain, I get really concerned. I would use the phrase freaked out. And I love Jean. I love everybody, but let's be honest. Jean has a little spunk in her that is the best thing that ever happened. And so I was coming here ready to have Elaine, right, do the children's moment session right before Sunday school, except I forgot that she's in Colorado celebrating her daughter and what her daughter's been able to do with her gifts. I'm like, crap, which means I barely made it here because I was actually on my way to the hospital. So Matt's run into my office getting the Bible for me. And we're setting up Sunday school, and we have it, and we have our opening. It's great. And then I jot out, which means I'm making it barely 5 minutes before the service, only to find out I didn't have to rush because John was preparing preparing a sermon. And even because we had the rock and the discipleship thing, he was all ready to bring in some Led Zeppelin and get it all set up, right? That is what it means to be the body of Christ. This is what it means to be the Epworth family. And Jean, this is for you if you are listening, because she was wondering if she was going to make it into the sermon today. And she was wondering if she was going to make it into the sermon when the nurse came in. And she was so parched and having so much trouble. And she's like, even there was a cleaning lady that came in last night, but she wouldn't give me water because she said she wasn't allowed to. And they didn't know if I could handle water yet. But I'll tell you, Kate, what I really want right now is a beer. I want it so badly I would jump in and swim in it. And then the nurse came in and decided that maybe she could have a sip of ice water instead of the beer. And Jean took the sip and took two sips when she was only supposed to take one, and then looked at the nurse and said, almost as good as the beer. So in celebration of whatever has happened and whatever we need to figure out for Jean, there is definitely a piece of her that is fully back and operational. And so for the joy to share in these moments together, and for our confirmands, we had hours of discussion yesterday as they are talking about why they have decided to follow Christ and why they want the Christian story to be their story and why they want to do that through the United Methodist Church and what about Epworth in particular. And almost all of them mentioned of the openness and the welcome that they found in the United Methodist Church, but in Epworth in particular. And we're talking about that afterwards in our conversation and question about where does Epworth need you and your skills and your leadership as you are accepting and preparing to become full members of our body together. And so we had talks about worship, and we had talks about committees, and we had talks about children's church and Sunday school. And so I bring this to you because the talks will continue. And where we welcome these members or about to be members into our body and into our leadership in a new way. And this is one of the greatest joys. We have Sylvia celebrating being grandmother. And what phrase did you use? Never felt closer to heaven or than being with the grandbabies. And I hope that that is our sense too as we celebrate the children that we have raised in faith, that we have made baptismal covenants with to nurture and to walk with as they become disciples that walk in the way that leads to life. And so as they are claiming that in a very new and powerful way, we will have the chance to claim that with them and to see what God will work in them and through them and with them in our midst and in our church community. So this is all kinds of an exciting moment to share together. And this is still in the Easter season. And pastorally, this was my first time with you all. And I just wanted to say again what a powerful experience it was. And just the level of participation for those who gathered in the Holy Thursday service and spent time washing feet. And I know that's a little bit safer these days than the nastiness of sandals and dirt roads and walking everywhere, but it's still feet, and it's still a very vulnerable moment. And for people who are willing to put themselves in that vulnerability and open ourselves up to see and to meet God there in that service. And then to live into our connection, right? There are often times when we do joint services together with churches in the area where not a lot of people show up because it doesn't really matter because it's not our church. And that could not have been farther from the truth for us and for all of those who came to the Good Friday service. And to see that you all are a church that take that connection seriously, that our family not only together here in our nuclear family, but are willing to make the commitment to being family in our extended family throughout Cockeysville is an incredible joy and honor. And in our whole Lent and Easter work of being present for other people in the midst of crisis through the UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief, we raised over $3,000. Alexa, do we have? Nope, sorry. We passed $4,000 raised. So thank you. Can we just have a moment? Can we have a little jingle? Oh, you're not. Let's have a little excitement, a little moment. So there is always work that needs to be done, but I want to take a moment to celebrate the work that has been accomplished, that has been done, that is being done through us and through our church, and just to say how proud and excited that I am to be a part of that. And we'll have mission trips coming up and vacation Bible school excitement and kids from the community coming in and the Baltimore County Christian Work Camp coming up where we're aware of the people's needs in our community and doing what we can to meet them. And this is all on the church level. And I know from pastoral conversations how much each of you on a personal level are seeing needs and meeting them with a meal or a visit or financial help and many other things that are not shared publicly, but needs that are seen and met because that is who we are. As disciples. So I want to thank you all for that. And at some point, we are going to work to have more opportunities to delve into Christ's teaching and learning with scriptures. But for now, we do have Thursday night. And so this is a perfect time to still come and join us. And if there is any scripture to read and study to understand of what this discipleship thing is about and following of Christ, it is definitely the book of Romans. We were going over last week, we owe the book of Romans the Protestant Reformation, as Martin Luther found in it a new understanding of salvation. It was when Aldersgate community was reading Luther's epistle, just introduction to Romans, that John Wesley had his heartwarming experience, and Methodism became not just a movement of intellectual and disciplined commitment, but one of heart and soul as well. So there have been a lot of pivotal moments that have happened in the history of our church through the book of Romans, and it is our prayer that that will happen here at Epworth as well as we study. So for all that has been accomplished, I just wanted to take this time to say thank you. And for all that is yet to be, I'll say yes. So let's continue to rock this discipleship venture. Let's continue to spend time in prayer together. Let's continue to spend time in holding all things in common, because I almost just left off the most important thing. Hello, we do this every day at the Thrifty Penny. And having a structure and a system in place where people can bring what they don't need anymore to get out to where people do need it in a way that happens with incredible amounts of labor and devotion. So Linda, Milton, Lee, wave your hands. Barbara, are you here too? So if anybody wants to help this process of sharing things in common, these are the people that you see. Because this is a practice that was at the core of the early church and just so happens to be a practice that we are in the business of every day at our church as well. So may we continue to come together and find these ways to be a blessing to our community and in this discipleship adventure. Let's be an Easter people that celebrates all the resurrection and all of the ministry moments that are happening. And we know that work takes a lot of work. And so what I want to be mindful of is for all that we are accomplishing and celebrating, this is Easter season. This is resurrection season. So this is our season where our commitments are to make sure that we are caring for ourselves as much as we are doing the work. Because if we do the work without caring and replenishing ourselves, then the work isn't going to be able to run the marathon. And we will be about a marathon and not a sprint here. So as much as we are celebrating all of the work that's happening, today's commitment is actually not to get out back into the work. Although if you've been doing Sabbath this whole time through, then maybe that is the next step to take. But if you've been in the middle of the work, your discipleship commitment for this coming week is the following. Because Christ has come so that we might have life and have it abundantly. That one was for me. get a babysitter, take a mental health day, go on a date, have a day all to yourself, get a massage. Anyway, we are called to love others as we love ourselves. And so the way that we share that love with others also depends on the way that we share that love with ourselves. So may that be space for that this coming week as we celebrate the love that has gone out through our church.